Let me begin by sort of establishing what you know about intelligence. It's a little bit of word association. When I say intelligence, what do you think of? What's spies? CIA. Information. NSA, National Security Agency. Okay.
Secrecy.
Spies, CIA, National Security Agency, secrecy, information. Let me ask another question. How many of you here collect and analyze intelligence? A few hands. How many think I just asked you who here is a spy? That's a common association as indicated by the first response to my first question. But if I ask instead, how many here listen to the radio or check the newspaper before deciding what to wear to work? Or check the movie schedule before departing for the theater? Or hope your favorite football team has done the scouting work before the next game. All of that is intelligence. And the analysis of it, whether done by a baseball scout, a government, a corporation considering a merger or entry into a new market, a university department, reading the work of a candidate for a faculty position, it's all intelligence. But mostly we think of the term in a more restricted fashion, which is secret work undertaken by components of our government in support of government missions. Whether one is thinking about intelligence in the narrow sense, or the broad, we all do it, our primary purpose is to reduce uncertainty. To narrow the range of the possible. To exclude some possibilities. To have a better feel for the availability, the content, the meaning, the implications of information. Information was one of the first words that I did hear over here. Information of whatever kind. What does it mean? Is it true? Why do I know it? Who wanted me to know that? Or at least wanted me to think that? What's the purpose? What's the track? All of that is part of the art and craft, the profession of intelligence. Spying, eyes in the sky, national technical means, satellites that intercept communications, take pictures from space, all of that is part of a collection effort to vacuum up information. And we collect a lot of it. Today, before you had lunch, the intelligence community of the United States collected an amount of information roughly equivalent to the total holdings of the Library of Congress. And it did the same thing after lunch. And it'll do the same thing tomorrow. We have a vacuum cleaner on steroids. that the technical capabilities of this country, and it's not all secrets, the vast majority of this is what in the parlance of the intelligence community is open source information. The rest of us just call that information. Newspapers, television, radio broadcasts, flyers put out by corporations, blogs on the internet, internet chat rooms that are publicly available to anybody. The intelligence community collects only a small fraction of what is out there, but it's a huge volume. As a career analyst, I am doubtless biased, but my take on all of this collected information is until it goes through the head of an analyst, it's just data. It's not self-evident. It doesn't order itself automatically in order to get the right information, the right analysis and judgments about information to the right people at the right time to make decisions. The reason we do intelligence, the reason we attempt to reduce uncertainty is to make the decisions made by U.S. government officials, civilian, military, dealing with the full gamut of matters that fall within the purview of government concern, to make them better informed. The hope is that being better informed will lead to better decisions. It's a hope. It's not automatic. All the information in the world doesn't necessarily make either the analyst or the policymaker smarter. It does make them better informed, but that doesn't automatically mean they're going to make the right choices or the optimal choice. And I'll come back to that. Lots of organizations, lots of people look at developments around the world, reach judgments about it, and put it into the hopper. Journalists do it every day. Pundits writing op-eds do it. Educators do it. Lobbyists do it. Think tanks do it. Why do we need one more set of people? And it's actually a big set. Intelligence community of the United States has about 100,000 people. Roughly one-fifth of that number are analysts. Why in the world do we need them? Since there's so much information and so many people working on it. What's different about it? I hope you'll have an answer to that question when I finish my talk. But let me set the stage further by exploring what you know and think about intelligence. Not because I want to use you as a foil, but because expectations of what intelligence can do for our nation, to our republic, are influenced by public perceptions. And one of the primary sources of information about intelligence is what? Books and movies. The world of fiction, the world of make-believe. James Bond, Jason Bourne. 24 hours. That's one of the reasons spies came back. Spies with, as the Joker said of Batman, oh, you have such wonderful toys. The incredible technical capabilities. But most of what most people know about intelligence, because it actually is, a lot of it is secret or classified, comes from the world of make-believe. And that doesn't just mean, in some almost pedantic sense, that that knowledge is wrong. Knowledge, it's information, it's knowledge that shapes perception, that shape expectation, not just of people in this room, not just of ordinary Americans, but of our representatives in Congress, of military commanders, of executive branch officials. We all partake in this mythology of intelligence. A second thing that everybody knows is about intelligence failure. 9/11, and the weapons of mass destruction that were not in Iraq. The combination of the fictional depiction and the photograph of the intelligence community on its worst bad hair day ever, that shape opinions, produce some rather strong but somewhat contradictory images. One is an intelligence community that is omniscient, that it does or could and certainly should know everything about everyone, everywhere, all the time. The 24/7 real-time monitoring of people, developments around the globe. We've all seen the TV movies, spies like us in the satellite watching the meeting around the campfire. Be nice if that were the case. Now, I don't know who would look at all of that video footage, but the idea that the intelligence community should be capable of finding answers to any problem at any time is strong, and it feeds into expectations. The flip side of that, the intelligence failure, is the intelligence community is a bunch of keystone cops that don't even know how to connect the dots. How is it that they can't line up the bits of data and get the obvious answer? The short response to that is finding the relevant bits of data in the petabytes that are collected every day is much easier after you know the outcome, after you know what happened. Then you're doing academic research. And I don't mean to disparage my future and current profession. Academics undertake study of topics where they know they've got enough evidence, they've got enough data, they've enough sources to do the study. They know how it turned out, and they want to explain why it happened in that way. Think of intelligence as a challenge to assemble a puzzle with give or take 1,000 pieces. You have 7. And somebody lost the cover to the box. And you're not even sure that all 7 pieces came from the same puzzle. One reason we spend a lot of time and money and effort on intelligence is the role should be to tackle the really hard questions, important questions that are hard. You turn to the intelligence community when you can't get the answer any other way, or we should be turning to the intelligence community for that. The third relates to the omniscient character, and that's sort of Big Brother, spying on Americans, violating civil liberties, the Patriot Act, FBI checking on who checked out what book from the library, kinds of concerns. For those of you who might have seen the movie J. Edgar, the behavior back in the 50s and 60s of the FBI. All of these characterizations are more wrong than right, in my judgment, and I hope I will convince you of that before I leave. But let me return to the going to the intelligence community on the hard issues, on consequential issues, not just intellectually challenging, but they matter. And they matter in what way? They matter because they have the potential to affect American interests, American security, the safety of American citizens, the success of American firms in the international community, the success of U.S. forces engaged in conflict, the effectiveness of weapons developed to deal with particular capabilities. The challenge here of interpreting that small number of pieces is real. Nobody wants to be wrong. The Iraq WMD, 9/11, failure to predict the demise of the Soviet Union, the dozen or so egregious so-called intelligence failures that are held up are there. But I used to get puzzled looks when I was Deputy Director of National Intelligence when I complained that the batting average of the intelligence community was way too high. Probably bat around 850. No, 300 will get you in the Hall of Fame. My point in making this observation is if we're getting it right 85% of the time, we're spending too much time on questions that are too easy, that ought to be beneath us, or could be answered using methods other than the expensive, sometimes risky, resources of the intelligence community and the very, very talented men and women of the intelligence community. The intelligence community exists to address questions that we can't get at other ways. Why do we use them in ways that seem a misuse of that talent? Well, there are very good reasons, and I'll come to them in a moment. Let me return to the myths and the expectations, because they, again, they're real. They shape perceptions, and they influence why officials turn to the intelligence community for answers. There's one of the most important ways in which intelligence analysts differ from all of the other folk who work on any problem is that they are supposed to be, the intelligence community is supposed to be, and in my experience, mostly is the most objective of all of the analysts' takes on it. Journalists want to sell papers. Lobbyists want a vote to come out in a particular way. Op-ed writers of whatever character are pushing a favored policy, are determined usually to change some aspect of American policy that they don't like. And they pick the facts to structure the argument by statute, by rationale, by professional ethics. Intelligence community is useful in direct proportion to its real and perceived objectivity. No policy agenda. Truth to power, call it as you see it. There are a lot of slogans that go around it. But people turn to the intelligence community in part because they can anticipate an unbiased response. There are many other reasons as well. Let me say a bit more about expectations that feed into this. Intelligence community is expected to provide warning. Perhaps easiest to make clear by saying the modern intelligence community created in 1947 exists as it does because of Pearl Harbor. It exists because no more Pearl Harbors. That was the motivation after World War II for the National Security Act that created CIA, the Bureau of Intelligence and Research, the National Security Council, and many of the other institutions that remained essentially unchanged until December 2004, with the Intelligence Reform and Terrorism Prevention Act. First time it had been reworked. To discover threats, provide warning in time for decision makers to prepare, to deter, to defeat, to deflect the threat, but to know it is coming. Bill Cosby had a routine many years ago on the dip signs in San Francisco, which were usually put right next to the dip. And instead of being a warning, prepare, you're going to hit it, you saw the sign right when you hit the dip. It was funny in his bit. It's also not very valuable as warning. If you can't give people enough forewarning, premonitory analysis to get a sense of what to prepare for, they haven't done the job. It's called strategic warning or strategic analysis. The rationale, the rhetoric, and in many ways the behavior still centers on threats, threats to our nation. It is reflected in testimony presented every year, late January, early February. It's called now the Annual Threat Assessment. Other times it's been, was the Worldwide Threat Assessment or Worldwide Threat Briefing. It's part of the budget process. It's used in part to explain the allocations requested in the president's budget for everything, for everything. Not surprisingly, threats mostly get dealt with by the Defense Department. The rationale for the expenditures, now almost $800 billion a year, when we don't have any enemies. But threats, that's still the language of it, have been redefined. Once upon a time, it was about existential threats to our nation and our way of life, the Cold War, the ideological and holistic competition with the Soviet Union. It in some ways seems a long time ago, but that really was about national existence. The prospect of nuclear incineration was real. You didn't want to be surprised. So it focused attention. Give or take three quarters of the intelligence effort for decades was directed at the Soviet Union. Soviet Union went away. We still have threats. We still talk about threats. But they change. That in testimony that I gave as Assistant Secretary in 2001, back then, the Congress invited four agencies, CIA, Defense Intelligence Agency, the FBI, and State Department, Bureau of Intelligence and Research, to present independent threat assessments. When I gave mine in 2001, identified international terrorism, and specifically Osama bin Laden, as the number one threat to the United States. I'd say that not I was preaching, George Tenet's testimony said the same thing. That's very different than what's the Soviet Union up to. The last annual threat assessment identified the weakness of the international economy as the greatest threat to the United States. That's not crazy. I probably would have agreed with it if I was still in government. We've broadened the scope of what we think of as a threat. It also includes international crime. climate change, infectious disease, terrorism, proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, counterfeit pharmaceuticals. I mean, the list is almost endless. One of the things that's changed in the two decades since the end of the Cold War is the elevation of a wide range of other problems or challenges to the status of threat, of the expansion of the array of government officials and agencies who have a piece of the threat management action and turn to the intelligence community for assistance. Why do they turn to the intelligence community? First of all, it's there. That there are days when I could be persuaded that we ought to change the organization, change the name to the National Analysis Program, because it is a very large collection of professional analysts who work for the United States government. They also, because of the collection capability, have access to more information than anybody else. Fair statement. The culture of objectivity, a culture of being responsive. It knows the mission of the agencies it supports. It knows the objectives of the officials that it supports. It can be targeted. It can be timely. The greatest analysis in the world is useful only for lining bird cages if it gets to officials 20 minutes after they've made a decision or 2 weeks before the issue's ripe. If they're not focused on it, and you don't have it in the terms that they're thinking about it, it's just noise. And the intelligence community is close enough to the people it supports to be able to provide that kind of support. So we've got, as I said earlier, a lot more information. We've got a lot more issues, a lot more customers. Turning to the intelligence community because it's there, and for anybody in the U.S. government, it's a free good. That $80 billion budget, that means if somebody in Health and Human Services, in State Department, in Treasury, in Commerce, has a problem, has a question, needs an analytic input, would like some more information, turn to the Intelligence Committee. But in addition to all of those changes, we've moved from the existential threat represented by the Soviet Union to threats to specific American facilities, embassies, overseas military bases, iconic buildings, to now, in the wake of 9/11, quite literally protecting every American anywhere in the world all the time. Just do the math on that. That takes the tough problem of worrying about the Soviet Union and multiplies it by give or take 6 billion. Because you're worrying about sort of individuals taking actions against American citizens. We've moved from, are the Soviets preparing to launch missiles, to is a disgruntled Nigerian who studied in Yemen planning to blow up his underpants on an airplane flying to Detroit on the day before Christmas. I think you can see the orders of magnitude difference in the difficulty of that task. But given what people have in their head about it, it seems like that's a reasonable thing. We've got all of this capability, and if you don't know that, you somehow screwed up. Or the priorities were wrong, and thanks to the advantages of hindsight, after something happens, it's easy to, you know, here's all of the evidence that you should have known it. We used to monitor a couple of nations. Now we monitor essentially all nations. lots of non-state actors, terrorist groups, illegal crime groupings, smuggling networks, money laundering networks, sources of disease. And it's different. Let me use an example of a real example. Question I got in 1994. I was Deputy Assistant Secretary for Analysis in the State Department. You may remember this is the time of the genocide in Rwanda. And hundreds of thousands of people had fled westward. And there were about 250,000 of them in a valley in what is now Democratic Republic of Congo. They're exhausted. They're dehydrated. They had just escaped. And colleagues in the State Department came to me and said, they're camped at the foot of a volcano. There are indications that the volcano, the Nyiragongo, which is the most active in Africa, might erupt. If it erupts, which way is the lava going to flow, and which way are the poisonous gases going to blow? My flip answer was, we had failed to spy on Mother Nature, had not tapped her telephone, and had no idea. But it was a serious question because the aid workers, and here's where the international community were turning to the United States for guidance, and we were going to provide the transport mechanism. Do you try and move 250,000 dehydrated, exhausted people away from a threat that may not happen, but if realized, will kill them? Just to complete the story, one of my colleagues, the geographer of the United States, worked for me. Bill went to the U.S. Geological Survey, who knew of a French volcanologist who specialized on this volcano. And within a matter of hours, we got back that it could well erupt. But if it does erupt, the lava is going to go the other way this time because of the structure of the cone. And the gases will go that way as well. Decision was made to leave the people there. The volcano did not erupt until 2002. And when it did in 2002, it actually would have hit the refugees. Were they still there? If you want to see neat photography, look up Nyiragongo volcano. That has become almost run-of-the-mill. Kind of questions for the community which knows how to and is supposed to plug into expertise everywhere. It's not simply spying on bad guys. It's not simply stealing information. It's knowing who's smart on what subject, how do you get to them, how do you explain exactly what you need so that you get an answer you can use and feed into the process. Decision makers, in my experience, always want more information. They believe, too, the more information they have about a problem, the more they will understand it, and the more likely they'll make the right choice, or the more likely that the policy that they formulate to pursue their agenda, whatever that happens to be, is going to be successful, that the spillover consequences will be correctly anticipated and prepared for in there. Where do they go? They come to the intelligence community and they say, put your collectors on this. In 2006, my boss apparently decided that I didn't have enough to do as the chairman of the National Intelligence Council, the deputy director for National Intelligence, and the one responsible for the president's daily briefing. So he gave me responsibility for the National Intelligence Priorities Framework. This was a matrix with input from policymakers to tell the intelligence community what they wanted in the priorities. And I said, the first thing we're going to do is reduce the number of priorities, because I can't keep a straight face and defend the 2,314 highest priorities of the United States. That number reflects sort of the breadth, the range of concerns and customers that want something from the intelligence community. And the capabilities, technical capabilities, human capabilities, are not limitless. And one example to illustrate it, that there were lots of things wrong with the Iraq weapons of mass destruction estimate. But one of the indisputable facts is that it was based on very little information. Stated such, we've got almost no information on this. One of the reasons the amount of information was as small as it was the zero-sum character of things that fly around in the sky. And the competition was between orienting them for purposes of force protection. The American planes flying in Operation Provide Comfort to keep the Kurds safe in northern Iraq, and a similar one in the no-fly and no-drive zones in the southern part of the country. Where are the anti-aircraft batteries? Where are the missiles that might lock in on American planes? The zero sum was do that or look area search for weapons of mass destruction. The decision was made, understandable, force protection. So we were blind. That capability wasn't limitless, and it isn't limitless now. The decision makers...
We'll be back with more from the World Affairs Council after this. The World Affairs Council of Inland Southern California is a nonpartisan educational group dedicated to the study of international affairs and foreign policy. Each year it hosts a series of lectures by visiting experts. Lectures are free to students. For more information, contact the World Affairs Council of Inland Southern California, your passport to the world.
The decision makers who will define almost everything now as a threat, because that's a way to make the intelligence community be responsive. The threat, geopolitical dangers resulting from global climate change. Okay, it's not a conventional threat, but it's important. It's important to American policymaking. So we go after it. Besides turning to the community to collect more information, they want more insight. If an issue is consequential for the United States, it almost by definition is complex. It almost by definition has lots of interconnected moving parts to it. So the desire to understand it is almost self-evident. So turning to the intelligence community for help. They want not just more information, they want help evaluating that information, integrating the information, interpreting the information, assessing the information, its credibility, as well as its implications, and assessing the developments. What's happening? What's driving it? Where's it going? What might change the trajectory of events? If I wanted to influence the course of events, what might I do? How might I intervene? I'll give you a Nigerian example later on desire to intervene. They want to know if something that they were told by a friend that was reported through diplomatic traffic, that a representative of another country relayed to them, the journalist picked, is it true? Pretty basic, is it true? the implicit second question is, if it's true, do I have to do something about this? And if I have to do something about this, what's the timeline? How much time do I have to work this problem? And what might be effective? And the intelligence community does not and cannot make policy recommendations, but it's designed to answer the questions that would help people formulate policies. I hope to illustrate that in a bit. But this drive to understand developments that could affect American interests. Could. And if it could, how fast? Again, decision maker needs to know, where do I put this on my agenda? I'm trying to work 20 things here. Is this one I gotta do right now? Do I expend political capital with other countries now? Do I wage the bureaucratic and budgetary battles within our own government on this one now? Or can I kick this one down the road a bit? Intelligence analysts are the ones who attempt to provide answers. Let me shift to the relationship of intelligence analysts and policy decisions. And here I think there's a short way to capture it. Intelligence usually informs policy, makes people better informed, or as I told classes after class of new analysts, our job is not to make ourselves smarter. It's to make the people we work for smarter. Intelligence is like that BASF commercial. We don't make a lot of the things that you buy, but we make a lot of the things that you buy better. Intelligence should be influencing all kinds of decisions. Much of the time, decision makers are looking for a second opinion. They understand it. They think they understand it. Think of it as going to a doctor. You need a pacemaker. Thank you, doc. Maybe I'll get a second opinion before going under the knife. An awful lot of what policymakers ask of intelligence analysts, is a second opinion, an objective second opinion, to reinforce their confidence in problems that they've been working on and for which they are responsible. But it informs the decision. It sometimes drives decision. Two examples that illustrate that. In 1988, I was chief of the China division at the State Department. And on a Friday night, one of the things for those of you who have worked in Washington, crises only happen on Friday night. So you have to work through the weekend. Friday night, we discovered Chinese intermediate range ballistic missiles in Saudi Arabia. Secretary of State George Shultz was meeting with the Chinese foreign minister on Sunday. And naturally, he wanted to know what happened. Why did the Chinese sell the missiles? Nobody had ever sold intermediate range missiles before. Why did the Saudis buy the missiles? This one is a case where he could not let the opportunity of the meeting with the foreign minister go by without raising this issue, without expressing some U.S. judgment of presumably dismay that the Chinese had sold, but also dismay that our ally in Riyadh had bought them, had done this behind the back of the United States. The discovery of that information And the judgments we made, I happened to write the side of it, which was the why did the Chinese do it, drove U.S. policy. Another one, different kind of example, Congress in the early 90s wrote into legislation a prohibition on providing assistance to any group in Cambodia that cooperated with the Khmer Rouge, the bloodthirsty Pol Pot regime that killed, give or take, 2 million of the 6 million Cambodians. It was an obvious and understandable feel-good kind of, no U.S. money can go to anybody that cooperates. The problem was the U.S. supported a group led by King Sihanouk and his son, Ranariddh, called Funcinpec. They were considered the relative good guys in Cambodia. And they and the Khmer Rouge were opposed to another faction, Khmer People's National Liberation Front, if you care about being in the weeds. And there was evidence that in an instance, the Sihanouk faction had made available trucks provided by the United States to transport ammunition of the Khmer Rouge to attack their common enemy, the Vietnamese-backed KPNLF. Legislation was clear. Any evidence, you cut off aid. Evidence was there. We had to present it. Lots of supporters of aid to Funcinpec, you know, jumped all over the intelligence community. We had brought news that forced the United States to honor a legislative commitment that we didn't want to honor. And I remember going around for weeks and weeks and weeks with the late Steve Solars on this. Now, the evidence is absolutely clear. I don't like the implication and the consequence of that either, but I can't change the evidence. That's a case of driving policy in an unfortunate way. The third is intelligence does not, should not determine policy. It should not determine what decision makers do. It should inform it, but not determine. That's for the people who are elected and the people who are appointed to make policy decisions. And that line is usually pretty clear, that the hermetic seal between analysis and policy, in theory, is unbreachable. But of course, if it really were hermetic, policymakers would not be able to communicate effectively with analysts who wouldn't know what they need and couldn't be effective. Another little anecdote. I remember briefing Secretary Albright on a Mideast issue in time. I got done. She said, "Thank you, Tom. What should I do?" I said, "Madam Secretary, you know, I'm an analyst. I don't do policy." She says, "Right. I'm a policymaker and I don't do analysis. What should I do?" I dodged a second time and said I really didn't know the full panoply of concerns that she had with respect to the countries involved, and therefore I shouldn't give advice because I wasn't fully And she said, "Tom, if I didn't respect your opinion, I wouldn't ask for it. Doesn't mean I'm going to listen to you, but I want to know what you think." So, of course, I did the responsible thing, which was to step over that line between analysis and policymaker, and then had to make doubly sure that in subsequent analytic pieces that went through me, that I wasn't fiddling with them to show how smart I was or how good my advice was. You've got to recognize and respect that break. Because if the intelligence community looks like it's just another interested advocate organization, there's no reason to spend a nickel on it. It's got to be objective. Let me bring this to a close by beginning to bound as well as to illustrate efforts to fulfill expectations. Intelligence community really does think of itself as a can-do organization. You say, well, for $80 billion and 100,000 people, 20,000 analysts, you ought to be able to do almost anything. It actually shakes out to not very many people per issue on here. But it tries. Sometimes it tries too hard. Sometimes the right answer is, I have no idea. We can't get useful insight on that in the time you have. That's the responsible. Sometimes a community tries too hard, and it guesses, and it exceeds sort of reasonable inference from scarce data. Mostly not, though. Otherwise, that 85%, give or take, sort of accuracy number wouldn't be there. And that's, I made that up, that number. I mean, it's based on having seen and processed a lot of analyses that one of my staff calculated that I had signed out somewhere around 13,000 pieces to the president or secretaries of state over my years as a senior analyst, and that doesn't include the 8,000 or 9,000 more that I did as in charge of the president's daily briefing. A lot of stuff goes forward. More customers want more help on more issues and think the community ought to be able to do this, and the community doesn't do enough to say, that's outside our purview. But an illustration of politics interacts with this. I'll make up this dialogue because it captures with our Senator Dianne Feinstein, who asked me to do a piece on global climate change. I said, Senator, don't know anything about global climate change. And the NIC doesn't know anything. National Intelligence doesn't know anything about climate science. She says, but I respect you. I said, thank you very much. I'm glad that we've restored confidence after the Iraq WMD, but we still don't know anything about this subject. Ask NOAA, National Oceanographic Atmospheric Administration, ask the National Science Foundation to do this. We don't have the expertise. She said, in effect, I'm on the Intelligence Committee. I can make you do it. I'm not on the committee for NOAA or National Science Foundation. And you do geopolitical change, right? I said, yes, we do. She said, good. Do the geopolitical effects of global climate change. And we did. As we've moved from the big, slow, predictable Russian bear, Soviet Union, to all of the other kinds of subjects, it also changed sort of the speed with which we have to respond. I can illustrate that. We used to worry a lot about the Soviets building missile-carrying submarines, boomers, as they were called. We'd learn that they were going to build another one. We'd watch them lay the keel. We'd watch them build this thing. We'd watch it go to sea trials. We'd watch it come in. We'd watch it be outfitted. We'd watch it go out and exercise. And we'd watch it be deployed. And over that time, my kids went from kindergarten to college. Literally. It was that kind of pace. Now, we're into the volcano in Zaire kind of concerns. We're into operational intelligence. Where should those drones flying over Afghanistan, where should they strike? Who's in the house? Are there an unacceptable number of innocents in the area? And that's a very different proposition from monitoring the kind of things that we did in the past. The shift in the focus from the security of the nation to the security of individuals. Boy, that's tough. Boy, that's tough. And yet, safety of individuals is now part of the mandate because of the 2004 intelligence reform that eliminates most of the barrier between domestic law enforcement and international intelligence collection. A barrier erected in the 70s because of violations of civil liberties by the CIA and the FBI. Those attacks, and well enough to do anything. But real advantages to do it. But it gets pretty close to spying on Americans. And the Patriot Act, in the eyes of some, transcended it. But the thing to remember is that intelligence professionals are Americans too. And it's our civil rights and civil liberties, as well as everybody else's. And this is a no-joke issue for us, particularly those of us who are in senior management jobs over the last decade, who sort of came of age during the Pike Church hearings on intelligence violations and went through the lying of the Vietnam War. And this is personal, as well as, quite simply, if you spy on Americans, if you go to jail, that you monitor American phone conversations without a court order, you go to jail. And driving that in. Two more examples, and then I'll stop for questions. One is actionable intelligence. That I can illustrate this with both a hypothetical and a real. We knew for decades that the Soviet Union targeted a very large number of American cities. I'm sure Riverside was on the list. We knew it. We didn't evacuate for 40 years, Riverside. Now, one report that indicates a terrorist group or a lone terrorist intends to shoot up an elementary school here in Riverside. Mr. Mayor, what do you do? We had a real one here on a closing tunnel, the Baltimore Tunnel. You have them all the time with respect to hotels in Honolulu. These are tough. At the level of sort of threat to cities all over the country, you're aware of it, but what are you going to do about it? Here, what's the responsibility? So the demand for, is this accurate? Can I trust this report? A lot more burden on the intelligence apparatus to get it right. As Americans, you need to know, and you can be proud. On its worst day, the U.S. intelligence community is by far the best in the world. It doesn't have a crystal ball. It doesn't get it right all the time. But it does contribute to the policymaking process every day. Let me thank you and open it up to questions.